Went to University of Tennessee, and my daughter Rachel is the same age as Mr. Henke, who's going to speak to us this morning. You know, I was there the day that he had the hit that changed his life and brought him here to us this morning. You will be totally inspired. I've heard just a few clips from him, but I haven't heard him personally, so I'm thrilled to have him here this morning. And I've had so many people come to me once they find out that we had signed him up to come and talk with us this morning and say, you will be totally blown away. So I'm going to turn it over to Inky. This is Inky Johnson. He was a University of Tennessee football player, and I'm thrilled to have him here.
Thank you.
And he's one of my heroes.
Good morning. Man, I'm honored to be here. Before I get started, I have to express my gratitude to my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, for this moment. You know, every day above ground is a good day. If you don't think so, try missing one. I'm sad it works for you. But before I get started, I have to express my gratitude to John. Thank you so much for thinking enough of me and putting me before your group here. Mr. Cash, you did an amazing job, man. Amazing story. Maybe give him another hand. Mr. Smith, thank you very much. I don't know if I'm many people's hero, so I appreciate you. But I know I am my kid's hero, so that means the world to me. But before I get started, I played a little ball in my day, and so I keep a football in the trunk of my car. But this football, this is my son's. You know, I left mine's over in Cleveland, Tennessee, so if you guys see me about to leave this ball, please, please, make sure I don't, because if I get home without this ball, me and my son will have it out. I got a 3-year-old boy, and he's pretty rough and tough. But before I get started, I want to do something with this football. I want to place it in some of you all's hands. And the thing I want you to do for me, as soon as you touch it, whether it hits your fingertips or your palm, I want you to tell me the first thought that pops into your head.
Physical.
Yeah, I don't discriminate. Tell you now. Let the woman touch it. What you say? Flags. What you say?
Winning.
What you got?
A locker room.
Locker room. What about you, man?
I'm grateful to play.
Grateful to play. Yes, man. What about you?
Roll Tide.
Oh, my God! You know, there's so much to be said about, you know, when we receive blessings or when we pray or, you know, how to make things happen in life, but it's very little to be said about what do we do when God says no? Or what do we do when we have given everything we have and everything that we have given is simply not enough? What do we do when we have worked our whole life for something, has sacrificed, has dedicated ourselves to something, has committed ourselves to something, and it just doesn't pan out the way that we want it to? How do we respond? You see, the reason that I placed this football in some of y'all's hands, I remember so vividly the first time I ever touched a football in my life, and I was coming up in the city of Atlanta in this neighborhood by the name of Kirkwood. And at the time I was coming up in Kirkwood, Kirkwood was one of the roughest areas in America. Drugs, gangs, violence, you name it, we had it. I was growing up at 125 Lawrence Street, and my mother had me when she was 15 years old. We were living in this two-bedroom home, and there was 14 of us living there. And I used to sleep on the floor. My grandmother had this amazing rule. One night out of the week, we got the opportunity to sleep in a bed. And when I got my opportunity to sleep in a bed, there'd be six of us in the bed, three at the foot and three at the head. And so I had this cousin by the name of Taman. So every night we would go out on the street, we would race light pole with no shoes. We thought it would help us gain speed. And so one night we were out on the street, we were racing light pole, and I heard this voice call my name. He said, "Hey." And I turned around, and it was my Uncle JJ. There was a football in the air, and so I caught this football, and I tossed it up, and I played with it, and I looked at my cousin, and I said, "Man, this is it." And he said, "Hey, what are you talking about?" I said, "This is our family's way out of poverty." I said, "This is my mother's way of never having to work another day in her life." I said, "I'm going to put everything I got into chasing this dream of going to the NFL. You see, God had blessed me to be extremely talented. I could shoot basketball with the best of them. I could play baseball with the the best of them. I could get out on the track, outrun the best of them, but it was something about the game of football where I can hit another individual with everything I had and not get in trouble for it. I fell in love with it. And so I still remember when I played rec league football, and after practice, everybody would leave to go home, and I would always be the last kid in the park. I'd be sitting on the bench, and I'd have my helmet and my shoulder pads sitting to the left of me, and I would be looking up at the lights and envisioning myself making plays in the NFL one day. You see, when I was a kid, I was a visionary. But sometimes it was painful, because the thing about being a visionary when I was a kid, I could always see where I wanted to go in my life, I could always see what I wanted to become, but I always had to come back and deal with the raw reality of life. And the raw reality of life was this: no matter how many touchdowns I scored in a football game, no matter how many points I scored in a basketball game, no matter how many people I outran on the track, every night I came home I had to sleep on the floor with roaches and rats. And so sometimes it was painful seeing what I wanted to become. And so when I would be sitting on that bench almost every night, as soon as the last light would go out, my mother would pull up and it would be dust going everywhere. She used to drive this old Buick Regal, hubcaps off the car, the seats all torn up, the car was all beat up. And she would pull up and she would put that car in park, and I would jump up off that bench. I would spin over to my mother, I would give her the biggest hug and the biggest kiss that I can give her, and I would say, "Mom, if you don't mind, can you sit back in your car and turn on your car light? I have to do some extra drills, I have to go to the NFL." She would never have to work another day in your life. And I knew my mother was tired. But my mother would always make the sacrifice, and she would sit back in that car, and our car light was at the field. He had the 7-year-old kid doing backpedaling drills, running sprints, running laps, chasing his dream to go to the NFL. And always beyond those car lights, I could always connect with my mother's eyes. And so it made me dig a little bit deeper. It made me run a little bit further. It made me push a little bit harder. I was also the kid that would be up at 4:30 on Saturday mornings with my father. And my father, he was a tall guy, he was a passionate guy, and he loved sports. But my father was never a believer in God when I was a kid. And so my father would always say, "Son, I need you to pull that other person outside of you today." And so I love the process so much. I love getting up at 4:30 in the morning, chasing my dream. I love the sacrifice. I love the dedication. I love the commitment. I wasn't like these kids today. I didn't have the million-dollar dream with the minimum wage work ethic. I didn't hope for it more than I worked for it. I didn't wish for it more than I worked for it. My expectations never exceeded my efforts. So it wasn't a problem for me to get up at 4:30 in the morning and chase my dream. It was what I wanted. And so if I wanted this, I had to accept whatever was coming with it. And so if getting up at 4 o'clock and 4:30 in the morning, running miles and miles to a fire station, if that's all it took, that was simple. And so my father would always say, "Son, I need you to pull that other person outside of you today." And so I would always give him a head nod, and I went up to the line, and so I was ready to go. And so he would usually get beside me, and we would take off on a yard run. And so one Saturday morning, he got me up at around 4 o'clock, and I think he did it on purpose. And so he said, "Son, I need you to pull that other person outside of you today." And so I gave him a head nod like I usually do, and I ran up to the line. But this morning, he didn't get beside me. And so he kept pacing in front of me. He said, "Son, I need you to pull that other person outside of you today." And so me, what registered in my mind, I said, "Pops just doesn't want it. It's early." He started talking his way out of this thing. He just doesn't feel like working. And so I stepped back and said, "What other person, man? What are you talking about? Let's work. Who is this other person that you're speaking of? I thought it was just me." He said, "Son, listen, I want you to hear me, and I want you to hear me clearly." He said, "Hey, no matter how hard you work, there is somebody inside of you that works even harder." He said, "No matter how dedicated you are, son, there is somebody inside of you that's more dedicated. No matter how committed you are, son, there is somebody inside of you that's more committed. But here's the catch. I need you to pull that other person outside of you, not just in sports. I need you to pull that other person outside of you in everything that you do with your life." I said, "So you want me to empty the bucket?" He said, "Yes, sir. When you go to sleep at night, mister, I need that tank on E. I like to call it the Porsche concept. The first time I ever rode in a Porsche before in my life, I was with a realtor. We were in a parking lot. We were walking to go look for a home for my family, and so I'm walking behind her. And so she kept turning around. She said, "Inky, come and ride with me." I said, "No, ma'am, I'll follow you." She said, "Inky, come and ride with me." I said, "No, ma'am, I'll follow you." You see, I don't claim to know much, but the thing I did know, I've been my wife ever since we were in the 5th grade. And the thing I know about my wife didn't want me riding a car with another lady when she wasn't around, so I wasn't doing it. And so she kept asking, "Inky, come and ride with me." And so eventually I didn't want to come off as rude, and so I agreed. I said, "Okay, I'll ride with you." And so we walked up on this black Porsche, beautiful car. I got a lot of friends in the NFL. They don't even drive Porsches, they drive pickup trucks. And so I sit down on this Porsche, and she takes off, and she's showing me all the gadgets and the tricks, and she's driving really fast. And so I thought I should let her know she was driving really fast, and so I leaned over to her. I said, "You're driving pretty fast, you think?" And she looked back at me. She said, "Oh, you haven't seen anything yet." I said, "Really?" She said, "Yeah, I'm only in the first gear." I said, "Well, how many gears do you have?" She said, "I have 3. But I take that situation and I correlate it over into my life and some of you all's lives. And I thought I was all in, and I thought I was giving everything I had. And my father was saying to me, "Son, I need you to pull that other person outside of you." What he was really saying to me was, "Son, you're operating in gear 1. You have 2 more gears that you haven't even tapped into yet. Son, you haven't even scraped the surface on your potential. Son, you haven't even pushed yourself to the point where you feel as if you can't go anymore. You have to dig a little bit deeper. Because the thing I want you to understand is this, son. There will come a day when you will hit a certain piece of adversity and your strength alone won't do it. You will have to pull from another place. And so by the time I got to high school, I got it. I was pretty good at every sport, not in particular because of me, but I had an amazing support staff around me. I had some amazing people that saw something in me, but I didn't see it in myself. I'm a firm believer that God will strategically place people in all of our lives in order to help us to get to the places that He wants us to go and to become the individuals that He wants us to become. Because you can only imagine, I had to have people around me that saw something in me when I couldn't see it in myself, because no matter what I did on a basketball court, no matter what I did on a football field, you can only imagine going out scoring 40 points in a basketball game, going out scoring 5 touchdowns in a football game, and coming off of that field and have people praising you, have people telling you, man, you're the greatest thing since sliced bread. But when you get home, you're sleeping on the floor with roaches and rats. That's a big shift in emotions. And so God had to place people in your life that saw something in you when you couldn't see it in yourself. God had to strategically place people in your life to propel them, to fuel that dream that you had. And so I had some amazing people that I didn't want to let down, but I was facing some extreme odds. I was attending one of the lowest performing public schools in the whole state of Georgia. Right now, today, it is the lowest performing public school in the whole state of Georgia. The dropout rate was higher than the graduation rate. People didn't go to college. They used to shoot the teachers. The name of my high school was Crim High School. They used to call it Crime High in Atlanta. My mother and father attended that same high school. The name of it was Murphy High School. They used to call it Murder High in Atlanta. But here I was, this kid with these big dreams of going to Division I. And so my freshman year, I excelled in the classroom. I excelled at every sport, forceful athlete. At the end of my freshman year, my parents came and said, Inky, listen, I'm going to transfer you to the school across town. The coaches that came to us, they said, all you have to do is play the next 3 years. They guarantee you a scholarship to the University of Georgia. This was a big deal. Nobody in my family had been to college. This would have made me the first generation of college student in my family. So I said, Mom and Dad, you know what? I really appreciate your offer, but I think I can make it for Crime High School. He said, son, the chances of that happening is slim to none. I said, yeah, but I think I can do it. I said, Mom, this is why we're in the park when I was 7 years old and you sat in your beer regal with your car lights on, right? I said, Pops, this is why we got up at 4:30 on Saturday mornings and ran miles and miles to that fire station. And when you would drift off, I would look back at you and say, son, keep going. There's nobody working right now but me, you, and Michael Jordan. And whether that was true or not, I believed it, right? I said, yeah, but at the end of the day, what do you think they did? They transferred my little butt anyway. And I couldn't be mad at them because they really wanted to give me a shot. And so I went from one of the lowest performing public schools in the whole state of Georgia to one of the top programs in the whole state of Georgia. And so I'm from inner city Atlanta. We used to play tackle football in the street and on the tennis courts, and Tucker High School is a little bit on the suburbs of Atlanta. And so when I went out to Tucker High School, I said, man, you know what? Let's show these cats how we do it back in Kirkwood. And so coach said, hey, what number do you want? I said, give me 21, prime time, Leon Dion, baby, let's go. First football game, who won it first? I won it, give it to him, I guarantee you it'll be 6. He said, okay, Amy, I'll give you what you want. First quarter, first play, he called the bubble. I catch the bubble, I cut it up, go for about 10 yards, ended up getting tackled, ended up at the bottom of the pile. Guy grabbed my ankle, he twisted it, he tore the ligaments in my ankle, out for the season. Ended up in a wheelchair, got out of the wheelchair, I was on crutches. Went back to my parents, would you please transfer me back to one of the lowest performing public schools in the whole state of Georgia? Father said, no, suck it up, I'm not going back. At the time, my father wasn't in the church, my mother was. And so I went to my pastor at St. Matthew's Baptist Church, I said, listen, you have to transfer me back to Crim High School. You have to get my mother, man, transfer me back. He set up the meeting, and the meeting went like this. He said, Ruby, listen, if it's in God's plans for Inky to go to college, Inky will go to college, you can't make that happen. If it's in God's plans for Inky to go to college, not your plans, if it's in God's plans for Inky to go to college, Inky will go to college, you can't make that happen. She transferred me back. The first game of my junior season, I come out and run for over 100 yards in the first quarter. This particular play, we do a draw. Linebacker hit me, I end up breaking my collarbone, out for the season again. So the thing you have to understand about me coming up in Kirkwood, I was that kid that would go to the drug dealers. I was that kid that would go to that one Amoco gas station that we had with the gang members. And I would say, hey guys, you see this community? I'm going to be the one to change it. I would say, you see Crim High School? I'm going to be the one to put Crim High School on the map. You see my family situation at 2 back home, 14 individuals? I'm going to be the one to change that. But back when I was coming out of high school, your junior year was the year college scouts come in, evaluate your tape, see if they wanted to offer you a scholarship. That would happen a lot earlier. They got Lane Kiffin down at the University of Alabama. They're allowed to offer a kid in the 5th grade. We don't have to worry about those guys. They will be on probation in a couple of years, I guarantee it. And so I had to take a shot at it. We had no scholarship offers, right? And so I'll be walking home, and so the drug dealers would approach me every day. I had to literally walk through them every day, and they would say, "Hey, aren't you the same guy that said you want to change this community?" I said, "Yep." They said, "Hey, aren't you the same guy that said you want to change your family situation?" I said, "Yep." They said, "Hey, aren't you the same guy that said you want to put Crown High School on the map?" I said, "Yep." And then they would proceed to say, "Your future's not looking so bright. Maybe you'll end up in one of these corners like your uncle selling drugs, going in and out of prison." I got an uncle that just got out of prison for doing 10 years behind selling drugs. Had eight uncles, six out of eight had been in prison multiple number of times. So I got really discouraged. It's kind of like that quote that says, "People too weak to follow their own dreams always find a way to discourage you from following yours." They didn't have the faith to do it, they don't want you to have the faith to do it. They didn't have the courage to do it, they don't want you to have the courage to do it. But that has nothing to do with you. Never let a person's opinion of you become your reality, right? So God sent this amazing man and this amazing coach by the name of Darren Miles to Crim High School. Had no business coming to Crim High School. He just so happened to be Jamal Lewis's high school coach that played running back at the University of Tennessee, went on to have a great career in the NFL. So after my senior season, he called Coach Philip Fulmer to our school. Coach Philip Fulmer came and he sat in my coach's office, and up prior to that point, I wasn't even qualified to get into college. I didn't even have an SAT or ACT score. So college coaches would come and see me and they would say, "Man, you're extremely talented, son, but we're talking about you graduating high school." And I would beg and plead with scouts. I would say, "Offer me a scholarship." And they would say, "Hey, it doesn't work that way." And so up until that point, I had been rejected. And so when I sat in my coach's office with Coach Philip Fulmer, he looked me dead square in my eyes. This is why he is my guy. And he said, "Son, I want to offer you a full scholarship to the University of Tennessee." I wasn't even in position to graduate high school. I said, "Coach, I'm coming." He laughed. He said, "Inky, I don't even think you understand how this process works." He said, "Son, first you take an official visit up to the university, you see the city, you hang out with the coaches and the staff, and then you make your decision if you come in." I said, "Coach, I don't think you understand." I said, "Coach, you don't want a kid that comes from a two-bedroom home, 14 individuals." I said, "Coach, you don't want a kid that sleeps on the floor. You don't want a kid, and when I did get the opportunity to sleep in a bed, there would only be six of us in the bed, three at the foot, three at the head. You don't want a kid that used to race to be the first one at the bus stop to shake my book bag and my jackets out to make sure there were no ropes and rats. Someone and I would walk off of my front porch, and my Uncle Johnny, who had been on the corner selling drugs all night, he would stop me in my tracks, and he would take off his white t-shirt, and he would put it on me. But the thing about this white t-shirt, my Uncle Johnny wore 5X. I was 139 pounds standing at the bus stop with a 5X dirty white t-shirt on, and my uncle had been selling drugs all night. So when I tell you I'm coming, I'm coming. You don't even have to waste the university's money. You give me the date, and I will be there." He said, "Yeah, but I still want to just take an official visit." And so I did. So I got up to Knoxville on that Saturday night, and my host was Jason Swain. And so he's running down the itinerary to me and said, "Hey, listen, there's a sorority party over here, there's a barbecue over here, there's a basketball game over here. Which one do you want to go to?" I said, "Man, if you don't mind, can you take me back to my hotel?" He said, "Man, did you not hear me?" He said, "There's a sorority party over here, there's a barbecue over here, there's a basketball game over here. Which one do you want to go to? We can go to all three if you want." I said, "No, man, you mind taking me back to my hotel?" He said, "Okay, I'll still get my stipend." And so we pulled up to the Marriott over off Summit Hill, and as I'm getting out of the car, he said, "Man, hold up." He said, "Are you sick?" I said, "No, I'm not sick." But what he didn't know, when I got up to that room, that was my first time being in my own room with my own bed. So I could care less about a sorority bar. I could care less about a barbecue or a basketball game. I got up in that room, I got on the phone, I called my boys back at Kirkwood. I said, "Man, y'all ain't gonna believe this." I said, "Man, you boys gotta go to college." They said, I said, "Man, you get your own bed." They said, "Ain't shut up." I said, "King size at that." I said, "You guys gotta go to college." But the next day when I saw Coach Philip Fulmer, I thanked him, and I got back to Kirkwood, and I went on those same corners, and I went to that same gas station, and I told those guys, I said, "Man, I told you guys I was going to college." So now people's comeback was, "Ink, why did you go back to Crim High School? Why didn't you just stay across town and Tucker High School? Easier route, better resources, you probably would have been better prepared for college." I said, "You guys are missing the boat." I said, "It's kind of like when you ride an airplane and you go to the restroom in some of these airplanes, and as you're leaving out, there's a sign on the wall that says, 'It's common courtesy to the person that's coming behind you, can you wipe the sink out even better than you found it?' Well, it's common courtesy to the generation that was coming behind me to Crim High School, I was about to leave it better than I found it. Whatever sacrifice, whatever dedication, whatever commitment had to go into making that happen, I was willing to do it. See, the thing I understood about my life, my decision and my choice didn't have to do nothing but Inky Johnson in this situation. Every night I slept on the floor, I had three little cousins that slept on the same floor as me. And so I wanted to remove any justification or any excuses. That's why I went back to Crim High School. And as a result of my sacrifice, you know, my three little cousins there that slept on the same floor with those ropes and the rats, they got their butts up and they went to college. It changed my family's life. When I got up to Knoxville, a lot of people didn't know how I had made it because I was 5'9", 153 pounds. I wasn't recruited real highly, and I was this skinny kid. I didn't even look like I played football. And so the football players would go out on campus, and people would be hyped, they would be stoked, they would be like, man, it's Rob Me or Robert Ayers from Norman Foster, man, this is football players. They would get to me, and they would say, what sport are you playing? And I'd say, oh, I swim, you know, give those guys a ball. Because I was so small. And so a lot of questions circled around me, and so my freshman year came, and I played a little bit of special teams. My sophomore season came, I broke the starting lineup. I played at a real high level. I had a really strong sophomore season. So the summer heading into my junior year, everything was going great. I was on track to graduate in 3 years. The same kid, when I first hit campus, he told me, son, you may want to stretch your graduation plan up to 5 years, depending upon where you're coming from. I was bench pressing 325 pounds. I was running a 4.38 and a 40. I was cat-like quick. My football IQ was through the roof. I had talked to several NFL scouts, had been discipled spiritually. My life was in shape. All I had to do was play the next 10 football games, and my life would be changed forever. And me and so many others have been working so hard for our whole lives. And so I'll never forget, we came out the first game, we played against California Bears, and my assignment was DeSean Jackson. I shut him down, got an interception, a couple big hits, a couple pass breakups, everything went great. Second game, we come out, we're playing against Air Force. These guys didn't even supposed to be on the schedule. Coach agreed to put them on the schedule at the last minute. Found ourselves in the dogfight. They came in and kneeled on this triple option, which you don't see every week in the SEC. Gave us fits. The fourth quarter rolled around, Air Force went down, they scored. They came back, they onside, kicked the ball, guess the move, me. I jumped forward, I missed it, a guy on Air Force team hit me really hard. Air Force recovered, now Air Force had the ball, went for the winning drive in Neyland Stadium. I'm mad, I'm frustrated. And so we go in the huddle on defense, the middle linebacker at the time, Marvin Mitchell. He said, quarter's covered, it's ready to break. I said, guys, get back in here. I said, listen. I said, whoever gets the ball on Air Force's team, let me get it. I said, let me hit him. I'm going to hit him. I'm going to break his spirit. I'm going to make him fumble. I'm going to recover the fumble. Then I will run it for a touchdown. I guarantee it. The story will end right here. So Rob Mayo looked at me. He said, Ink, you want us to just go to the sideline and make this play by yourself? I said, yeah, man, I'm feeling that type of way right now. And so this play started to unfold as slow and as clear as I've ever seen a football player unfold in my life. I remember watching our left defensive end, Robert Ayers. He came off the line of scrimmage, had a clear shot at the quarterback at the last minute. The quarterback sidestepped him, and he missed it. I remember then I shifted to our roll linebacker. The running back was coming by on the line of scrimmage. Roll linebacker was supposed to key him. The running back crossed our roll linebacker's face, which let me know my roll linebacker had busted. His eyes got caught inside. Immediately, my eyes shifted to the quarterback. The quarterback was releasing the ball to the running back. I started running forward. I kid you not, I said, thank you, God. I got exactly what I asked for. Be careful what you ask for. He just might give it to you. But I went at this tackle the way I always approached a tackle. And the way I approached a tackle was simple. It's either me or you. And I'm giving everything I got, and I'm not blinking, and I'm not moving. So either I'm about to knock you out, or you're gonna knock me out. But at the point of contact, when I hit this guy, something different happened that had never happened to me before in my life. At the point of contact, when I hit this guy, it seemed as if every breath in my body left. My body went completely limp. I fell to the ground, I blacked out. When my eyes opened, my teammates ran over to me. They said, hey, get up, let's go, man. I said, I can't. Came back over to me and said, what do you mean you can't? You always get up, man. We need you. Let's go. I said, I know, man, but this time I can't. I said, there's this shock going through my whole body. I can't feel anything. I remember as I was lying there, the shock eventually left, but it stayed in my right arm and hand. I looked at our doctors and the trainers. They were coming onto the field. I flipped my head up to the sky. I said, God, surely nothing has happened in this moment that can alter my life. I flipped my head back over to the left. They were bringing the spine board out. I flipped my head back up to the sky. I said, God, I said, he had to do that, right? So that's precautionary measures. They get me up on the spine board, they take me off the field, I get to the ambulance, my father was waiting there. I said, Pops, did I get him? I said, yes, son, but I think you got the worst part of it. We get over to the hospital, they take me back, they run some CAT scans, they bring me back into my room, and all in a 15-second time frame. My father, he took a step in, he couldn't stomach it, he walked out. My mother walked in, she said a quick prayer by my bedside, she walked out. As soon as she walked out, the doctor walked in, he said, hey, get in here, we gotta rush this guy back to surgery, he's about to die. I said, what happened? He said, son, what happened? You have busted up the platelet artery in your chest and bleeding internally. Have to rush you back and take the main vein out of your left leg, plug it into the chest in order to save your life. As soon as I opened my eyes from recovery from that surgery, the same doctor was standing over me. He said, I have some good news and some bad news for you. I said, you have some bad news for me after telling you I was about to die? He said, yes. He said, the good news is we saved your life. He said, the bad news is you have nerve damage in your right shoulder. You don't know how much you have to send you up to the Mayo Clinic. I remember thinking to myself in that moment, I said, man, my career can't be over. He said, you probably can't play the game of football again. I said, man, no disrespect to this doctor. I respected him. I respected his profession. But this doctor wasn't in the park with me and my mother. This doctor didn't get up at 4:30 on Saturday morning. This doctor didn't sleep on that floor. This doctor didn't come from that two-bedroom home, 14 individuals. I had faced adversity before. I remember being a kid waking up on Christmas to no gifts because somebody broke into the house on Christmas Eve while we were there and took everything. I remember being a kid standing in the parking lot watching our two-bedroom home burn down behind a drug deal that went bad, and we had nothing to do with it. When it's 14 people in a two-bedroom home, you don't have much. I remember being a kid and I know my next meal was coming from and walking into my grandmother's room, and I didn't have to say a thing, and she would be sitting on the edge of her bed reading her Bible, and she would look at me and she would say, son, everything is going to be okay. That night we were eating syrup sandwiches. I had faced that adversity before. Nothing had ever stopped me. Everything that I encountered along the way, I looked at it as a hurdle that I had to get over in order to get to where I needed to be with my life. I said, there is no way that my career could be over. I remember watching my mother work a whole month. She took a check for $50 and she bought me some cleats, and we rode to a convenience store right after that. She looked at me and said, son, I'm about to go in here and risk my freedom to steal you some drawers to put on your hind end. So my mother took her check and bought me some cleats so I could chase my dream, and she would rather go risk her freedom to steal me some drawers to put on my hind end. And now you're telling me I can't do this anymore. That doesn't resonate. This can't be true. And so I said, ship me up to the Mayo Clinic. There is no way that my career could be over. And I remember thinking to myself, I said, man, you know what? I'm going to go to sleep every day at 6 o'clock. And I'm going to wake up the next morning, this thing will be all over with. This has to be a bad dream. And I would wake up every morning, and I would touch my arm, and I would try to move it. Still couldn't feel it. Try to bend it. I still couldn't bend it. And so the final visit came at the Mayo Clinic. It said, Inky Johnson, here's the deal. It says, son, you have torn all the nerves and you break your plexus. You break your plexus is the nerves that go from your spine and control your arm and your hand. It said, you have torn them at all levels. It said, it can't be replugged. It said, son, your arm will never be the same again. It said, your hand will never be the same again. It said, son, we need to tell you that you can never play a game of football again. It said, we understand prior to college, you have been a four sport athlete your whole life, so you can never play basketball again, you can never play baseball again, your home will never be in condition for you to run track again. What do you do when all your options get taken away in the instant? And then they proceed to say, here are your surgery options. You can take a muscle out of the back of your left leg, plug it into your right arm, but there's a possibility that you'll be left with a weak left leg and a weak right arm the rest of your life. Or you could take a nerve out of your left arm, rewrite it up from your chest down to your right arm, but there's a possibility that you'll be left with two weak arms the rest of your life. Or you can take a nerve out of your left rib, you got it up to your chest, down to your right arm, but there's a possibility that you'll be left with a breathing problem and a weak right arm the rest of your life. Tell us what you want to do in the morning, by the way. I was 20 years old and I don't know if anybody in this room has ever felt this way, but when I walked out of that office, I tried my best to make it to my hotel room door, but it seemed as if every step I took, the burden got heavier and heavier until it literally weighed me down to the floor. And I stopped in the hallway with my mother and my father. I said, what would y'all do, man? What option would you choose? Because I'm going to be honest, I needed some answers, and I needed to quit. And I remember looking at my father, and I could see the anger, I could see the disappointment on his face. And he looked at me, and he said, Ink. He said, the only two people in my life that I considered to be good people that did things right was my mother and you. He said, I lost my mother when I was 15 years old. And he said, now this has happened to my son. He said, son, I remember when you were at the top of your game, and I would call you and I would say, Ink, you're about to go to a party. You would say, nah, Pops, man, in the Bible study. And he said, for the life of me, I just don't understand why bad things happen to good people. And he took his hands and he slammed them down and he hit the floor. And he said, I'll tell you all that they can do. I remember I shifted. I looked at my mother and she was bald. And I said, Mom, what would you do? And in the midst of her tears, she said, son, don't you worry about it. He said, God is in control. That's where my faith comes from. Right in that moment, I looked down at this black bracelet and I used to play every game in it. I did every workout and I never took it off. And after a game when I was coaching on Kiffin's staff, it's probably the only good thing that came out of Kiffin being at UT. And I was coming out of the tunnel and this kid walked up to me and he said, can I have that? And I said, what, this bag? He said, no, that. I said, what, this hat? He walked right up on me and said, no, that. And it was that bracelet. Looked at him, looked at the bracelet, took it off and I gave it to him. Said, that's something special. But on that bracelet that night in Rochester, Minnesota, in that hallway, by conviction, that bracelet read, man of faith. You see, I was just like everybody else. You got faith? Yeah, I got faith. Big faith, big power, right?
Little faith, little doubt. Hebrews 11:1. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. I knew all the faith lines. Faith and fear can't reside in the same mind, but I had yet to be placed in a situation that required me to use my faith. And when I was placed in a situation that required me to use my faith, I was left questioning God. Can I tell you something this morning? A faith that has not been tested is a faith that cannot be trusted. Faith in God means faith in God's timing. The next morning I got up, I went into the doctor's office. They said, son, what option did you choose? I said, no disrespect to your doctor. I'm not choosing an option. My situation is out of your hands. They said, what do you mean your situation is out of my hands? We're some of the best doctors in the world. We are the reason that you came up here. I said, no disrespect to your doctor. My situation is out of your hands. I'm not choosing an option. I know it will come out and it's okay. And as I stand right here before you today, I think I came out okay. As a matter of fact, I think I came out 10 times stronger. For a number of reasons. First and foremost, I'm a firm believer that God has never made one mistake. And the things that happen to us in life, they're not designed to stop us, but to reposition us so we can come in contact with what God really has for us. Things that happen to us in life, football, it's not designed to stop us, but to reposition us so we can come in contact with what God really has for us. You see, when I came out of that hospital, my whole life changed. I had been right hand down my whole life. Now I had to learn how to write all over again. Now I had to go out to people in public that didn't know what happened to me and say, hey, can you help me tie my shoe? Now I had to get help with taking a bath. Now I had to get help with getting dressed. Now I had to get help with 85 to 90% of the things that I needed done on a daily basis. My whole life changed. And so I remember I was sitting in the cubicle in disability services one day and I just said, God, what's up, man? What's up? Not questioning you, but what's up? I gave everything I had. I sacrificed for this. I didn't do drugs and I watched drugs get cooked up in my house. I watched my uncles and friends rob people and I never robbed people. I never joined a gang. I did everything right for the most part. I walked the straight narrow. I sacrificed. I dedicated myself to something. I went to Bible study. I gave you the Lord. What's up? And it was as if God said, hey, take inventory over your life. Think about everything that you have been through. It's kind of like the battle of David and Goliath. Think about the backstory. And I thought about everything that I had been through. I thought about when I was in the park with my mother when I was 7 years old. And now I think about the mindset that I created. I thought about getting up at 4:30 on Saturday mornings and running miles and miles to that fire station. Now I think about the spirit that they had created. You see, God had prepared me for this battle a long time ago. Meaning I couldn't quit, I couldn't give up, I couldn't give in even if I wanted to. I couldn't go in the tower even if I wanted to. I took the towel, I wiped the sweat from my face, I put it on my back and I kept it talking. Because God had already prepared me for this battle. Let me tell you how God does it, right? And I know you don't need this dollar, but I'm handing it to you because I want to make an example. I hand you that dollar, right? Now if I didn't hand him that dollar, I couldn't ask you for a dollar because I don't know if you have it or not. But because I gave you that dollar, now I can go to you and say, hey, let me get that dollar, right? That's how God does us with situations. He'll never take us to what he won't bring us through. He has already equipped us for every battle that we face. Now he can ask it of us because the thing that God understands is this. God gives his toughest battles to his strongest soldiers. He'll never ask nothing of you if he hasn't already equipped you. He won't take you to a tough storm if he already hasn't given you the tools to deal with that storm. See, the thing I understood my whole life, God will never put more on you than you can handle. It's the battle of David and Goliath. When we face battles in our lives, God has already prepared us for the battle. You think about the battle of David and Goliath. You ask the average person, you say, hey man, how did David defeat Goliath? And what's the first thing that a person will say? By his faith in God. Yes, that's very true. But what most people miss is the backstory of how David got prepared to defeat Goliath. David's father made him tend to the sheep and take his brother's food in the army. And so by David tending to the sheep, David took pride in what he did. He took so much pride in what he did that one day a beast came and got one of David's sheep that he tended to. And so the beast had David's sheep and he had his sheep in his mouth. And so you know what David could have easily did? David could have easily said, man, that's just one sheep. Kill it. Just like we can say, man, it's just one day I'm going to take for granted. It's just one moment I'm not going to appreciate my family and appreciate the things that happened to me. It's just one moment. David could have easily said, that's just one sheep. But you know what David did? He took so much pride in what he did. David went into the mouth of the beast and he took out his sheep and he slayed the beast. So if you have slain a beast and another person comes to you and they want you to fight a man, now they want David to fight Goliath, but David had been fighting the beast. And so now when the moment presented itself, David is looking at him like, man, you want me to fight another man? I've been fighting the beast. Bring him. And he slayed him. The same thing applies to us in our lives. When we face adversity, when we face opposition, we should look at adversity, we should look at opposition, and we should be honored. We should say, really? Life, is this all you got? When life threw me this blow, I said, if that's all you got, you're in trouble. If this your best blow, if this all you can do is paralyze my right arm and hand and think I'm going to quit, and think I'm going to give in, and think I'm going to give up, and think I'm going to turn my back on God, we're in trouble. I'm honored that God. life. It's all about our perspective. Every day we wake up, we should give everything we got to everything we're involved in, because it creates a certain spirit. We should give everything we got as fathers, we should give everything we got as mothers, we should give everything we got as men and women, because it creates a certain spirit and it shows God. It's kind of like that Colossians 3:23 mindset. Do everything as if you're doing it for the Lord and not for man. And when you do everything as if you're doing it for the Lord and not for man, you can't help but to be all men. You can't help but to empty the bucket. And by emptying the bucket, you show gratitude to God. Today, let's go out and be a blessing to someone. Let's make our existence mean something. Let's pay our rent for living. Be honored when you face adversity. God has an incredible plan for all of our lives. Jeremiah 29:11, my life force. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. It doesn't matter what comes up against Inky Johnson, because I know God will take it and use it for good. That's my time. God bless you all. Thank you.